Good morning, everybody. The psalmist said, "So great is his steadfast love towards those who fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far does he remove our transgressions from us." Isn't it so wonderful that we serve a God that loves us and has such mercy upon us? Let us prepare this morning as the prelude is played to worship and to celebrate that we are here with God this morning. Amen.
Good morning. We are glad you're here to worship with us at Richlands First Methodist Church this morning. We're glad to see all you out today, and we thank our bells for a good old-time religion medley to get us going. So if you will, take a look at your bulletin for the opportunities this week. We have several. It's kind of a quiet week this week, but next week on the 11th, Sunday, will be fellowship dinner with Team C. Card Ministries on Monday, the August the 12th. Tuesday the 13th at 8 o'clock is men's breakfast, and Saturday, August 17th, is the open door supper. Pantry items, you got all the peanut butter we could need, and we've changed over for the month of August to any kind of canned vegetable, 14 to 16 ounce size. So take the opportunity when you catch it on sale, buy it and bring it in. They're looking for any kind of vegetable, so anything that you see, it helps them. Have a better way to purchase for the food pantry, because the lowest price they can get for a canned food is 89 cents. And if you do a sale, you get it even better. So they appreciate your help and your willingness to help stock the pantry throughout the year. Are there any other announcements this morning? Any others? Well, we are glad to be in the house of the Lord this morning. So let us stand together and turn in the Cokesbury to hymn number 92, Tell It to Jesus. Hymn 92, Tell It to Jesus. We'll stand together and sing.
Are you weary?
brother, tell it to Jesus alone. Do tears flow down your cheeks unbidden? Tell it to Jesus. Tell it to Jesus. Have you sins that to men's eyes are hidden? Tell it to Jesus alone. Tell it to Jesus. Tell it to Jesus. He is a friend that's well known. You have no other such a friend or brother. Tell it to Jesus alone. Do you may be seated.
Let's take a moment and go to God in prayer. Father God, you are all victorious. You are glorious, filled with holiness, and you reside far above us. And we worship you this morning. We lift you up on high. For that is the way that we gather strength to ourselves, is by lifting you up. For you in turn strengthen us, you guide us, you lead us, you bring us into salvation, and you allow us your peace, even in times of the darkest and most tragic storms. Lord, we thank you for all that has happened this week, whether it be positive or negative. For you grant us great opportunity in the negative to exhibit our faith. And as the Apostle Paul would say, that opportunity is always and ever present for us to be a good witness in the world by showing our faith when things don't seem to go our way. So, Lord, be with us this morning. Grant us peace and grant us courage. Sanctify us through the glory of worship, through the wonderful news that we get through Sunday school lessons and through Bible studies, through time alone with you, and through this time of prayer. We lift up those who are so important to us in our life. And so often, Lord, we think it is selfish if we lift ourselves up in our times of need. But nothing could be further from the truth. For we must draw strength ourselves before we can strengthen others. So, Lord, we lift up each and every person here in this place this morning. For whatever it is that they're going through, whatever challenges they might be facing, we lift them up to you. You already know what they are. But we voice them in our hearts. We cry out to you, O God, please attend to our needs and help us in our time of distress. Bring us greater joy in our times of wonder and just the joyous times in our life. Increase that joy of salvation in us. And through our faith, Lord, strengthen us and prepare us for what is ahead. For we know not what we are to face tomorrow. But we know that today has its own troubles, and Scripture tells us to worry about today, and tomorrow will have its own. But we take this opportunity, Lord, to draw strength from you, to draw courage from you for tomorrow, and to bolster our faith so that we are able to stand strong even in the darkest storms. Thank you, Lord, for all that you are doing in this church. Thank you, Lord, that you are working in the background in our community and in our nation. There is so much that is coming up in the coming months that is controversial and might draw us into negative conversations, negative ways of thinking. Bring us again to the reality of the knowledge that you alone are in control, that you have things in the palm of your hand, and because of that, we need not fear what comes tomorrow, but rather we can look forward with great joy and anticipation to look into what's happening and see what you're doing, to see the brightness of the sunrise, to see the glory of the sunset, and to bring another day into our physical life. Heal us, touch our lives, and draw us closer to you this morning as we pray the prayer together that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. If you will, please stand and take your Methodist hymnal and turn to page 881. And if you would please stand, and we will recite our faith as is found in the Old and New Testament scriptures. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
If you will remain standing, and we'll turn in the Cokesbury to hymn number 231, His Eyes on the Sparrow. And I don't know if you know the history to this little hymn. It was written by Savoia Martin after visiting the Doolittles. The Ms. Doolittle had been bedridden for 20 years, and her husband was confined to a wheelchair but continued to work. And her and her husband commented on how they still had such a delight and happiness about themselves. And when they asked her, they said, you know, what is the secret of this? And Ms. Doolittle's response was simple. His eyes on the sparrow, and I know he watches me. The beauty of this simple expression of boundless faith gripped the hearts and fired the imagination of Dr. Martin and his wife, Sevilla, and the hymn, His Eyes on the Sparrow, was the outcome of that experience. So let's sing together hymn 231.
Why should I feel discouraged?
You may be seated.
Thank you.
So we have concluded our study on the book of Esther. We're going to move into a new series this week called You Are a Conqueror. And I hope you drew some strength and encouragement from the book of Esther as we went through it. And I hope you'll be there on the 18th to see the production of that as we have our ice cream social. I hope you'll be a part of that. But let's start this in the book of Job this morning. I'll be reading from the second chapter, verses 7 through 10. And since we're going back to kind of short scripture, so if you would please stand for the reading of God's word this morning. So Satan went out from the presence of the Lord and struck Job with loathsome sores from the sole of his foot to the crown of his head. And he took a piece of broken pottery with which to scrape himself while he sat in the ashes. Then his wife said to him, "Do you still hold fast to your integrity? Curse God and die." But he said to her, "You speak as one of the foolish women would speak. Shall we receive good from God, and shall we not receive evil?" And in all of this, Job did not sin with his lips. This is the word of God for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God. You may be seated. So, I guess the question for this morning is, have you ever been disappointed? You ever had something happen to you in your life that kind of rocks your world and you don't know what happened or what you did to deserve it? You kind of do this self-evaluation and you think, where did I go wrong? What is it that perhaps I've done that has caused such a thing to happen to me? And in the Christian life, so often we turn it to the discussion of, what have I done to displease God that He has struck me with this affliction? How do you react in situations like these, in the midst of disappointment? Do you react like Job and say, shall we accept good from the Lord and not trouble? Or is there perhaps another way that you react to those situations? We need to remember that Job was a healthy and wealthy man. He had everything in the world to lose, and God allows Satan to test him. Satan is allowed to do anything except kill Job. And Job's wife is someone who doesn't take disappointment very well, I guess you might say, when you see what she says. She advises Job just to curse God and die. Not really the best solution in my particular opinion. And I wonder sometimes how a woman could possibly say that to her husband. Just go ahead and die. Just go ahead and be bitter. Just go ahead and lie in the muck, in the mire. The fact is it's not really fair to take the good in life for granted and then complain about the bad. We have to think about that on a daily basis. Have you ever considered how much we complain about the things that don't go our way? How much time and effort we extend and expend complaining about things that there's nothing we can do about, and there's nothing we did to cause, and there's nothing in the world that will change it, but we complain about it anyway. And we often take the position that we don't deserve this. We get frustrated and we get disappointed, and you know, we wonder why in the world life has thrown us lemons. Especially when we think of ourselves perhaps as one of God's servants. We're good people. We might live a clean life. We might live as well as we can according to the scriptures, as well as we can to attend to things like worship and Bible study and Sunday school and the opportunities that God grants us to worship Him and to be close to Him. Why would God afflict us with what's going on in our life? And you have to plug in what it is that's happening in your life, whether it's cancer or perhaps another physical ailment or financial troubles or emotional distress. Because when we look at the scriptures and we think about, do we really deserve what's happening, we have to look at what the purpose of the book of Job really is. And it's to remind us that even a good man who doesn't deserve what's happening to him can often live a life of challenge. And we will. He would have been completely justified, according to the world, to do as his wife had said. To just give up, throw in the towel, curse God for abandoning him, and just say to the world, I'm done. You know, I've tried to live the life of faith, and look what it got me. You know, the reality of it is that sometimes we need to take our losses with courage and quietness. Sometimes we need to make sure that, like Job, we wouldn't grow bitter or fall down in defeat. Job would accept the possibility that perhaps we can conquer the disappointments in life that we face with a spirit of gratitude for what God has richly provided for us, not for what He has allowed to be taken from us. Because life will throw you lemons. And we have two choices here. We can respond like concrete, or we can respond like clay. Job's wife decided the concrete route. She made the choice that she would allow the situation to harden her and to make her bitter, and to just say, in effect, the heck with God. Just give up on what you have believed so far. It hasn't gotten you anywhere. In fact, all it's gotten you is sitting in ashes with a bunch of sores that you can't heal, you can't do anything about, and you didn't deserve. What has this faith bought you? Dear friends, the benefits of our faith are so invisible so often. That's why they call it faith. Faith is behind the scenes. But Job's wife had allowed the situation of the day to steal her joy and to seal her in the concrete tomb of bitterness and despair that God had cheated him. That somehow God had cheated him out of a right life, out of a good life, out of a healthy life. I heard a story of a woman once that was diagnosed with incurable cancer. When the pastor asked if he could pray for her, she responded, "You can go ahead and pray, but it won't do any good." She had allowed that cancer not only to destroy her body, but to destroy her faith. She was choosing to allow the cancer to steal her joy in the Lord, and chose the concrete option to choose bitterness and loss and a sense that God had somehow ripped Job off. I see it all the time. I did a funeral yesterday, and some of the folks there felt robbed of the life of the lady who had died. They thought, what's this all worth, you know? And I had to preach on the faith that is behind the scenes, the faith that undergirds us and perhaps isn't right in front of us, that we need to remember that we are people that are constantly in a state of degradation, and that we will pass from dust that we were formed from to dust as we return to the earth. And it's going to happen to us all. It's just a matter of time, and we might as well be thankful In this case, for the 92 years that the woman had spent on this earth with her family and friends. It could have been shorter. It could have been more painful. It could have been a lot of things. But we draw strength from things like salvation, of knowing that when we pass from this life to the next, that it's not the end. That there is more to the story. In fact, there is more to the story after this life than there is in this life. Because of that, because of Jesus Christ, we need not fear. We need not take the concrete path and say to God, I don't understand why you're doing this to me. Because the fact is, some things just happen. But rather, I believe the Christian is called not to be concrete, but to be clay. To be moldable. And some people refuse to be overcome by bitterness and disappointment. Job said in the 19th chapter of the book, he said, "For I know that my Redeemer lives, and that he shall stand at the latter day upon the earth. And though my skin worms with destruction in this body, yet my flesh shall see God." Through it all, through everything that you and I can go through all of our challenges, through all of our disappointments, we can choose to be concrete and bitter, or we can choose to be conquerors, to side with the Lord, to be moldable by all that God can do, the great things that God can do through us and in us and around us. There are multiple stories filled with examples of such positive responses in negative experiences. To put it in an old vernacular, of people that made lemonade out of lemons that the world has given them. Think about David for a moment. He said in the Psalms, "I will bless the Lord at all times." And you would think maybe that was just a high part of David's life. But think of all that he had been through. Saul had been trying to kill him. Amnon committed adultery with his sister. His son Absalom betrayed him. His son Adonijah tried to steal the throne from him just before he died. Life was not going David's way, and yet he said, "I will bless the Lord at all times," because he saw something greater at work than what was happening to him. Even Jesus ran into his share of frustrating situations and disappointments. You think, surely not. Surely, the Son of God, everything went his way. But read the Gospels and look at how his disciples responded to some of the most profound evidences that he was the Son of God. And they still failed to understand. Things that he had been trying to achieve often turned into bitter failures. But when he died, he did not go out in bitterness, but rather with a shout of victory that it is finished. It is finished. That even through all the failures, Jesus Christ had won the victory, and there was more to come. It wasn't over. The Apostle Paul spent much of his ministry in prisons, and that alone must have been frustrating, but he never complained in writing about the deplorable conditions he must have faced, the bad food or the bad treatment by the guards. But rather, he spoke about how God was using his suffering for the good of the gospel, and how other people would benefit from his poor experiences. See, my friends, the challenges that you and I face, I remind you that people are watching. They're saying within themselves, "This Christian, what has their faith bought them? How are they responding to the things in life that would absolutely crush me, that would make me want to simply die rather than endure? How do they face it? And the truth is we can either look at every tragedy, failure, and disappointment as a reason to become bitter or an opportunity to step up and use it to strengthen our faith, to make it an opportunity to pick up the pieces and start fresh rather than fall to pieces and let bitterness set in. Job's wife had a faulty view of God through which she was seeing the situation. She thought God owed Job a trouble-free existence. Not. God doesn't owe us anything. We are the ones that are in debt. We are the ones who are the recipients of such immeasurable grace through the death of Jesus Christ that we cannot even count the blessings that truly are ours through the gift of salvation. Job saw God as He truly is, not as Job wanted Him to be. And I think that's a great lesson for us to remember, that we need to remember who God really is in the darkest of times for us, when we lose a loved one, when the diagnosis is not good, when we understand that life is coming to an end. Where is it that we will turn? We may tend to think that if God loves us, we will never experience pain or disappointment or heartache. But the truth of the matter is it's exactly the opposite. We become more acutely aware of what is happening to us, of what is happening around us in our life, and we are guaranteed that things will degrade in our physical life, our spiritual life, our emotional life, and our community life, because the world itself is degrading and has been since Genesis 3. It's something we can't stop. But will it do any good to become bitter and live with heartache all the time? Will it do any good to make poor decisions like cursing God and just saying, forget it, I'm done? You know, when something happens in your life that really rocks your world, right here is the place where you belong. Right here is the place where you will draw strength when you have no strength. Right here is the place that can heal the things that perhaps have come your way because you've made a poor decision that has affected your life or even your health. Or perhaps outside forces have messed up your world financially or emotionally or physically, and maybe even Satan has gotten in your world. See, not everything originates from God. Not everything that happens to us originates from God. There are things that you and I do in this life that have consequences for them. We can't blame God if we make a bad financial decision. We can't blame God if we eat the wrong foods and we end up with some kind of disease or something like that. We can't blame God when someone else's sin affects our life. Some things God just allows to happen, and we don't know yet why. But let me assure you that Scripture reminds us that God has His reasons and that God will always come out on top. When you side with God, when you side on the side of faith, when you draw strength from all that Jesus Christ brings to the table for you, then you can endure anything in this life. And you can come out on the other side smelling like roses, because you will end up in the day of resurrection. Praise be to God that through all of the things that you and I experience, God is working. God is working. You may not feel it. You may not sense it. You may not see it. And you may think God has abandoned you. But to believe that is to say that Scripture is a lie. Hold fast. Be a conqueror. God sometimes will heal people in this life, and sometimes healing comes, to put it quite frankly, sometimes healing comes through death. Sometimes the best thing that can happen to a person is that they die, rather than endure more pain on this earth. But one thing for sure, God can do a lot more with you and me in this life if we have faith than if we have bitterness. God wants us to stay away from being angry and feeling sorry for ourselves, to turn our thoughts from defeat to victory, to bring us from difficulty to the promises. Don't give up in despair. Don't let bitterness and doubt engulf your life. When difficulties and disappointments come at you in this life, turn to them and say, "My God is a God of victory and blessing, not a God of gloom and despair. My God is a God of redemption, not condemnation or punishment. My situation shall not rule my life, but rather I will ask the God of joy to rule my situation, and I will be satisfied with all that God blesses me with and His decision to what happens to me." Say to yourself, "I will not feel abandoned, for God promises He will never leave me or forsake me. And I won't feel ashamed, for my God has already redeemed me and has promised." Listen, folks, because this is important. God has promised that through the grace of Jesus Christ, He will not condemn you. So often I see people at the twilight of their life wondering if God can possibly forgive them for all that they have done in this life. How in the world could He possibly forgive me for what I have done? And the reality is we serve a God bigger than any sin we can possibly commit. And through faith, God can take away the shame and can take away the condemnations of our sins and our shortcomings. And we can simply say, "I will not curse Him and die, for He has not given up on me, neither will I give up on Him. I am a conqueror." Can you say that for me? Just say, "I am a conqueror. I'm a conqueror." Do you believe it? Will you live into it? Because I say to you today, if there's something in your life that's not going your way, if you feel cheated or disappointed, if your faith is wandering because of something that is happening to you, then lay it down here at the altar today before you leave and pick up the mantle of conquering. For you have a God on your side that is stronger than anything you can possibly face. And He is with you. He is for you. And He will always be your biggest cheerleader. You can do it. You can live this life in faith. You can run the race and finish it with integrity and without disappointment. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, dear God, let it be so in all of our lives today and forevermore. on the night that Christ was betrayed, he was having the Passover supper with his disciples. He took bread, knowing what was about to happen to him, knowing that he would be beaten, that he would face certain death, a horrible death. He knew that his body would be broken. He said, "This is my body, and it is broken for you. Take it, all of you, and eat of it, and remember me." When the supper was over, he took the cup. When he had given thanks, he said, "Take and drink from this, all of you, for this is the cup of salvation given for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins." And by all of this, he would remind them throughout time, through the next 2,000 years, he would continue to come to us in the form of bread and wine. He said, "Do this in remembrance of me, so that today you and I, as we take the cup and we eat of the bread, can be reminded that we are part of the conquering nature of Jesus Christ, that we are recipients of the resurrection. We need not live in defeat. We need not live in despair. We have the cup of salvation on our side." Let us pray. Father God, we thank you for this gift of bread and wine for us today, for the reminder that we are on the right side of heaven as Christians. As people of God this morning, remind us through the taking of the bread and the giving of the cup that we are conquerors in your kingdom and that we are recipients of all of your mercy and grace, that all of our imperfection is forgiven. We are made whole by what Jesus has done for us. Take this bread and wine today and make them be for us truly the body and the blood of Jesus Christ, so that we may be transformed today into the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood for the world. In Jesus' holy name, amen. We can have our own.
And turn to page 90. 94. God will take care of you. We'll stand together and sing hymn 94. God will take care of you, from the Cokesbury. God will take care of you, hymn 94.
There it is.
We give you thanks for these gifts, these tithes, these offerings that we are about to give. Thank you, Lord, for each and every gift that is placed in these boxes on our way out the door. Thank you for the gift of worship, of knowing you as a God who gives, and you ask us to simply be cheerful givers. Bless the gift, the giver, and the recipients in our community alike, that all may know that Jesus Christ is Lord through them. Amen.
Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy.
I go from this place not as just people of God, but as conquerors, but as people whom God has redeemed and who loves and who walks with each and every day of your life. Go and be powerful in the world. Through all your challenges, let God be praised and draw strength from knowing that He walks with you. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, may peace be yours now and forevermore. Amen.